Victor Hugo once said that there is nothing in the world more powerful than an idea whose time has come.
I had a hunch that we could do something that really foregrounded sound and an experience of sound as a way to be distinct and also memorable to people. So I kind of had this team out there looking while I was working on a book chapter related to the 1957 Royal Ice Cream Sit-In Parlor movement. And lo and behold, the speech that they came up with, which was the speech that Dr. King gave at the White Rock Baptist Church in February of 1960, just about a week and a half, 2 weeks after the start of the Greensboro Sit-In, was that speech. And it really did bring everything together. Its location had been torn down to make way for the Durham Freeway, and there was no known recording. We had transcripts from the speech, but no known recording of the speech. So it kind of was the perfect speech that came at the perfect time.
Let us not fear going to jail. If the official threatens to arrest us for standing up for our rights, we must answer by saying that we are willing and prepared to fill up the jails of the South.
So the very first phase was how to sort of reenact that at the current White Rock Baptist Church, even though that's not the original church. Then the second phase was to produce the audio recordings of the actual speech and making it available online for the public. And then the third phase, which we're currently in, is creating a 3D model as if you were actually on the inside of the sanctuary during the day that King gave the Fill Up the Jail speech in Durham.
Yeah, creating the model is really a challenge now because the existing church is no longer there, so we can't go out and just measure it and take photographs. So we're relying on historical documents, photographs, a few plans. We don't have a full set of architectural plans, so that's created a challenge for us. But we do have plans from the event where they installed an organ in the church, so we have a few really critical dimensions where we can start to pull from and build our digital model from those. But the photographs have been really helpful because that helps us to understand, you know, the window patterns, the textures on the wall, how many seats were in the auditorium and things like that.
We're not trying to make an exact copy. What we're trying to do is produce something that gives us a sense of what that was like and to help us understand what it was that transformed people that night and what can transform people today.
And what this project highlights is that in North Carolina, there was also very civic-minded innovations here as well. So to do a sort of project like Virtual MLK and bringing together the production pedagogical focus, but also the community engagement, really highlights the sorts of things that NC State does well. So we drew from expertise in audio-visual, also in rhetoric and communication, but we also drew from people who were skilled in media studies, helping us to think about the project, and also in film.
I think joining any multidisciplinary team, the first step is always, you know, getting around the table and understanding what each of you does and what you can bring to the project. And for us, Keon Pettaway, who was working on the project for a long time, has really been our chief researcher, if you will. He's gathered quite an array of images from church members from the past, from historical documents and archives that are in Durham. And so we've been using those.
There's a way in which people coming together to bring their creativity to bear on a research project or a social problem or a political problem or whatever it might be, really can do interesting and exciting things.
The experience has been one of mainly about the seeing the project grow, and in particular how the project has been engaged with the community. So as researchers and as developers and designers and scholars of the project, we have particular intentions, but once you put products out in the world, you never know what's going to happen.
The other thing for me is I grew up in Greensboro, and so I grew up always knowing about the sit-ins at Woolworth. So I didn't know the story about this speech at White Rock, the fill up of the jail speech, that occurred just a few days after those events in Greensboro. So for me, it's another step in a historical story where I knew parts and now I feel like I know more.
One of the misnomers of what some people thought about the project, right? That the project was mostly about Martin Luther King. It's another project about his life. But what the project exposes is that there were everyday people in Durham, North Carolina, students, people who were involved in religious organizations, who made a great impact on our society and its civic innovation. So what I would hope people would take away from the project is that a creative protest can be staged by anyone. You don't have to be a king to do so.
And remember that both history and destiny is on your side. All the stars in their course are supporting you. Go out with the attitude that God is with us and we have a cosmic companionship. And one day, historians in this era might be able to say, there lived a great people, a black people, who injected a new meaning into civilization.